A very good afternoon to one and all. I request everyone to keep your cell phones in silent mode. Thank you. It is both an honor and a privilege to be able to introduce a man of distinction, Mr. C. D. Balaji. He is a graduate in mechanical engineering from Bangalore University, and he did his master's degree in aerospace engineering from Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. He is a former director of LCA at Aeronautical Development Agency. He was responsible for the design, development, building, and flight testing of LCA prototypes at ADA, Bangalore, as a project director of LCA. On behalf of Sahyadri, I welcome you, sir. I also welcome Srimati Rama Balaji to this session.
Some of you were there in the morning session. Some of you were there? Okay. So some few things may be a repeat, but the bent there was a little more on the environment and its impact and a very broad overview. What I intend to do in the next maybe about an hour, I don't know how much time I'm given. Okay. Hour or hour and a half, whatever, depending on any doubts that are there. I'll take you through the journey of what design and development challenges were there in the development of the naval version of the light combat aircraft. As was introduced, I started my career in the Indian Navy. Way back in 1978 was my commission. So 28 years in the Navy, and as was already mentioned, I was at the Institute of Science. More importantly, I had aircraft carrier experience operating a naval aeroplane. So probably these two things put together, the naval headquarters decided that I move to ADA, and the Air Force version was already flying, and my role there was to take and build up a naval version of the light combat aircraft. So I think that was the primary focus. In 2002, I moved to ADA on deputation while still in the Navy, and finally I moved to ADA in 2006 permanently. What you see here in front of you are all the indigenous things. This probably repeat for the people who attended the morning session. Of course, the light combat aircraft, I hope you all recognize it. The advanced light helicopter, or the Dhruv, which is designed developed by HAL. This is the Saras, which is a 14-seater aircraft, which is developed by National Aerospace Laboratories. Tapas is an unmanned aerial vehicle, which did its first flight at Chitradurga. Missile program and obviously the space program. As you're aware, Tejas is a single seat, single engine, multi-role fighter aircraft. It's an unstable aircraft. And I interacted with some of the challenges, I think, who are present here. It's a challenge basically because an unstable aircraft, I'll give you a crude example. If you're going on a bicycle, it's an unstable machine, unless you artificially stabilize it. That artificial stabilization on a bicycle you provide by your own power, your own control, that you know, control through your body motion. Similarly, on a fighter aircraft, you make it unstable because you can have a huge amount of maneuverability, which is very critical. Between a bicycle and a tricycle, you obviously can make out a difference in terms of maneuverability. Could be a bicycle or a bike or whatever it is, or a scooter. But all of them are basically inherently unstable. You know, if you let it loose, it will fall. But then you artificially stabilize it. And that's the philosophy on which the flight control system of the LCA has been developed. And the challenge that I had given to the challenges in the morning was that you should have a flying wing as one of your projects. So we'll discuss that. So some of the salient features, it's about a 13.5-ton class aircraft. Can carry about 3.5 tons of external payload, which means that you can carry either external fuel tank or you can carry certain missiles or bombs or whatever in different combinations. It has supersonic capability, obviously, as a, being a fighter aircraft. Has both single and twin seat. Incidentally, I wanted to experience this aircraft. So I had an opportunity to fly in the twin seat aircraft, in the rear seat. So basically, it was able to take control. So the pilots had confidence that I can be sitting in the back and flying. So that is how it is. Of course, it has more roles than making me fly. That's a different issue. It has roles of air-to-air, air-to-ground, and air-to-sea. That means you can do a, something like a dogfight. You can carry a, like a close combat missile at the two wing tips that are there. So you can fire these missiles at another aircraft. So close combat missiles or beyond visual range missiles are primarily air-to-air weapons. For air-to-ground, you basically carry either dumb bombs or you can carry intelligent bombs. What are intelligent bombs? Intelligent bombs are basically something either you can have some kind of a terminal guidance mechanism or you could have something like a laser designated bomb called laser guided bombs. That means you have a inbuilt laser source which you lase a target, and along that laser target you can release this bomb and it goes and strikes the target. There is time I can play a small video which I played in the morning there, which will show you these aspects. And air to sea is basically you carry an anti-ship missile. That means you can target ships, enemy ships, and that is the role that it has. So it can do a combination of these roles. What are the challenges I would like to go through initially on the LCA program itself before we come to the naval version? This is one of the largest R&D programs in the country. And you know, one thing which happened in the LCA program was that there were no technologies in the country. And I'll show you some of the technologies in the later slide. And I understand most of you are ECE students. Or do you, what are the, which are the branches that are available? Sorry? I can't hear. Mechanical also there? Yeah. Beauty of aerospace is, you know, it can absorb all facets of engineering. And you will realize that as the presentation progresses. Because you need mechanical, you need civil. Civil engineers, in fact, had the structures design. A lot of work is done by civil engineers, actually. So we had civil engineers who were working, so just for your information. So we had in the civil engineering domain, we have instrumentation, we have electronics, we have, you know, aerodynamics, that is basically in the aerospace domain. In fact, my head of aerodynamics was a mathematics person. He's a PhD in mathematics, a lady who was a PhD in mathematics, was the head of aerodynamics at ADA at one point in time, my wife's good friend. There were more than 40 disciplines on technologies that were there, and about more than 100 work centers that were involved in the Tejas program, and about 300 industries, with HAL being the principal partner. The challenges which were there when the program started was that there were no fighter aircraft development over 2 decades when it started in the late 80s, early 90s. HF-24 was the last project, HF-24 was the last project which was done in 1960s. After that, there was no fighter aircraft development in the country. So that means there was a huge technology gap. You were moving from a second generation class of aircraft to a 4+ generation class aircraft, an unstable aircraft. So it was a huge technology gap that had to be filled up. So along with the aircraft, actually the technologies have flown. That's the important thing. It's not just the aircraft which has flown. It is the technologies which has flown also. Obviously, because of no development, there were no, once you don't use something, you lose that sense of proportion. So there were no design potential over the years. The computer and CAD-CAM facilities which are there today were non-existent at those points in time. So infrastructure had to be built up. We had to identify resources. So in fact, what happened in the LCA program was that people from various government departments or private sector came together into ADA from ISRO, from Department of Atomic Energy, from some DRDO labs, from HAL, etc. Everybody came together within ADA. You are asking why Department of Atomic Energy? It's a beautiful thing that they have done for the LCA program. Typically, you know, you have your plumbing in your house, you know, your water pipeline, etc. that are there. Invariably, sometimes or the other, it starts leaking. similar problems you have on the aircraft, but it's disastrous if it happens on the aircraft. You have a hydraulic pipeline or a fuel pipeline, you have a problem if it starts leaking. What, for the fuel especially, it's a problem. So what they did was they used something called, you know, smart materials were used, and they basically had a shrink fit, basically pipe joining mechanisms that are developed by the Department of Atomic Energy. And that is what is currently being used on the LCA. All the fuel pipelines are using these ferrules, and that is what is used for sealing. And we have not had a problem so far, touch wood. So indigenous design and development of various technologies had to be basically promoted. Now I'll come to the challenges that we had with the naval version. Basically, you need to operate from an aircraft carrier. Now, there are different types of aircraft carriers. Three, basically, fundamental types of aircraft carriers that are there. What we started with when I was in the Navy was something called a catabar carrier. That means you launch off a catapult. You must have seen some YouTube videos or so, launching an aircraft from a catapult. It just in about 100 meters or 150 meters, you are launching an aircraft. So it's called a catabar. That means a catapult launch, arrested recovery. Arrested recovery is by an arrestor hook engaging the wire. That is a catabar aircraft carrier. Now, that aircraft carrier which we had earlier in the Vikrant is no more there. It has been retired. Catabar carriers are there only with the US Navy, with the French Navy only. These are the only two navies which are operating a catabar carrier. Stobar is basically a Russian philosophy which came because we had the Admiral Goshkov, which is INS Vikramaditya now, which has a ski jump for takeoff and arrested recovery for landing. And this is the actual picture of a ski jump in Goa. And I'll come to that later in my slide on the test facility creation. So this was a challenge. So all that we have for takeoff is a 14 degree ramp, and you have about 200 meters deck run for takeoff. So one of the things that has been done here is that you have very little pilot reaction time. So there is an autonomous takeoff mode that was built for this aircraft. That means the pilot, after he's engaged his full afterburner, ready for launch, the flaps are lowered, he keeps his hands off. It goes on its own, leaves the ramp here, and after it leaves the ramp, the pilot takes control. So it's an autonomous takeoff that was demonstrated for the first time on the 20th December 2014 that we did this actual launch picture. So that's the important thing, because you have very little reaction time for the pilot to control things here. So you had to build this controller specifically. So that's where a lot of electronics, computer science people come into play in all this. Now for landing, you have just 90 meters for recovery. It's not called landing, it's a recovery. That means you recover the aircraft back on board. So the wire engages, the hook engages the wire, and then it's pulled back. There is a hydropneumatic system beneath the ship, which is what we have recreated at Goa. So we actually built a ship on shore. If you go down, like I was telling you, we had to build a 30 meters by 45 meters by 40 meters, and then we had to create this down below. So what happens if you have, in 90 meters if you stop, you have a 10-ton aircraft coming, you pull something like 4.5G. Can you imagine what happens? A 10-ton aircraft, 4.5G, means, translates to 45 tons of load. That means a single point, you have on the hook a load of 45 tons, and that load has to get diffused within the aircraft structure. So that's the challenge that was, there. So in terms of the structural design that is there, that's only horizontal load. All of you who are building aero models are familiar that you have a main keel member or the longerons that are there in an aircraft structure. That is where the loads have to get diffused. That is the horizontal loads. So something like a structural beam that comes in. Similarly, when you come in for landing, typically what do? You must have all flown or seen aircraft flights somewhere. What does it do when you land in a civil aircraft also? When the aircraft is coming in for touchdown, it comes in gently, kind of flares out, the nose lifts up a little, and gently touches down. And the moment it touches down, the pilot cuts throttle. And after the speed reduces, he starts braking. That's the normal tendency. He uses about 1.2, 1.3 kilometers to stop. So that's what is normally done. On a naval version, on an aircraft carrier, it's exactly the reverse. When you are coming in for landing, you don't flare out. It's called a flareless landing. That means if you are coming something like about you're about 140 knots, which means about 260, 270 kilometers per hour. That is where the aircraft is approaching. That's the speed. So the vertical component of that, you can imagine what's the kind of vertical rate of descent. 240, 250 kilometers per hour is something like 80 meters per second. So the vertical sink rate is about 4.5 to 5 meters per second. Normal flareless landing, which the landing gear goes through in a force aircraft or a civil aircraft, is something like about 0.8 to 1 meter per second. So this is 4.5 meters per second, a huge amount of vertical rate of descent. That's something that, so you have to, you know, the vertical loads have to be reacted in the structure. So you have a horizontal load from the hook, you have a vertical load from the landing gear. So that is why you design this, why 7.1 if it is only 4.5? The aircraft carrier is also heaving, because in the, when it is moving on the sea, it is moving up and down. It can move as much as 1 to 1.5 meter per second. So if it's 4.5 there and it's about 1.5 when it's coming up, it adds up to something like 6 meter per second. So you design for 7.1. That's the kind of design philosophy. So these are some of the challenges. Now why? What is fuel dump? Fuel dump is nothing but, you know, you have full fuel, something like about 3.5 tons of fuel that you're carrying. But then when you have to come in for landing, you have to restrict to about 1.3, 1.4 tons. The moment you get airborne from an aircraft carrier, if you have an emergency and you have to land back, you have to dump fuel. You cannot afford to carry that. So something like about 1 to 1.5 tons of fuel you do in 90 seconds, you have to dump it out. So you have basically fuel traces that are coming out. So that is for an emergency requirement, you have to have this fuel dump mechanism. So this is a, these are specific naval challenges that were there. Now this is what the Admiral Ghosh called an aircraft carrier looks like. Basically, you have a takeoff path like this. You have about 200 meters. This is the normal takeoff line. If you have a lesser load, this will be the line which is something like about 140, 150 meters. This is the kind of a, so if you have a lighter load, you can take off in a shorter distance. Now this is your landing path, and typically you have three arrestor wires which are there, and there's an optical landing system. That means the pilot is seeing the optical landing system. That means pilot eye, optical landing system. The hook sees the wire. That means, so it's a geometric relationship depending on the type of aircraft. So depending on whichever type of aircraft, you need to modify the setting in the optical landing system. The intention is that the hook touches between number one and number two wire. Halfway through, it's 12 meters apart. The reason is that if he's slightly high in an optical landing system, you basically have say five lights, center is green, and I'll show you a picture of that when you come to the SPT here. Center is green and there's a datum line. Slightly above that you have an orange steady. Above that orange steady you have an orange flash. Below the green you have a red steady, and below that is red flash. If you're slightly high, you will see orange. If you're slightly low, you'll see red. And you can catch either the number one or the number three wire in those things. But if you see a flashing light, you're off the mark. You have to go around and come back again. When you come in for a landing here, you're intending to come for a touchdown. You come down flareless. That means you're having a high sink rate. And the moment you touch down, suppose you have not caught the wire, then you're in problem. So what you do is, you thump the deck, bash the throttle. That means you open throttle fully as soon as you touch down. So what happens there is that if you have missed the wire, then you have adequate thrust to go around and come back. But if you are caught on, you have 45 tons of intrinsic load because of your deceleration, plus you have the thrust load of the engine which is also there on top of that. Till you are firmly engaged, and then the director on the ship tells you to cut throttle. Till then you will not cut throttle. So the aircraft is actually juddering with full thrust against the hook. So that's the situation that is there. So this is how a typical aircraft carrier is. Why the angle deck? You know, this is an invention of 1945, 1946 by the British, an angle deck for landing. The reason is that, you know, you have this, this is called the superstructure, which is like a building on top. So obviously if you cannot come in straight path, you will strike the side of the superstructure. So that's why an angle deck which can have a clear path for going around and coming back. The going around process is called a bolter. That means if you miss the wire, you go around, come back and again and approach. That's the philosophy. The third type of carrier which is there, this is what we have now in the country. The third type of carrier is called a Stovall carrier, which we had till recently, INS Virat, which is operating the Sea Harrier. It's the jump jet. Basically, you could do a short takeoff and vertical landing. STOVL is a Stovall carrier. So you have a catabar carrier, a stowbar carrier, and a Stovall carrier. So this is the types of carriers that are there. And each of them have their own design challenges and philosophies. Like arrestor hook has got a, from the tail section, you need to have the loads which have to be diffused. The catapult will have the nose section getting challenged in terms of structural loads. So these are the kind of challenges which I have already covered. So the ski jump takeoff, as I said, was automated. You had to do a telescopic landing gear to take the huge shock loads, arrestor hook for deck recovery. And then what happened is, introduced a new control surface called the leading edge vortex controller, which helps reduce the approach speed by something like about 6 to 8 knots, which is a great, a huge thing, because the moment you're able to reduce that much speed, that means your vertical sink rate comes down and therefore your loads come down. Some of the challenges in terms of technologies which were there, which were built up here, were the configuration and aerodynamics itself to build an unstable platform. Airframe structures, as probably I'll cover in this later slide, where we had this aircraft is primarily composites. Propulsion system is a digital control. That means it, you can fine tune the absolutely control. Avionics and weapon systems was the forte on this thing, where you have integrated avionics, and I'll cover that in this slide, the future slides. And flight control system, a big challenge to develop a unstable aircraft flight control system. Mechanical and electrical systems, of course, with all the high pressure hydraulics, electrical, digital brake management, etc. And a lot of these concepts have come to automobiles today. So there's a lot of similarities in aircraft design and automobile design which come in. And signature for future, where the lower radar cross section is required. Some of the major achievements in the naval version have been that the aircraft has flown supersonic, gone to higher angles of attack. Ski jump launches, as you know, you saw some of these pictures. If possible, I'll show you the video also. Something called field carrier landing practice, which is basically a dummy deck landing that is done. And of course, high sink rate landings. So, as I mentioned, 2003 was the government approval, March 2003 for the naval version. I mean, 2002 I went on deputation and got the government approval by 2003. And 2012, 27th of April 2012, we flew the aircraft. That means it was from a government approval, that is paper, took the entire journey of through these challenges and built up the aircraft to first flight in about 9 years. Then been basically also built up, sorry. So built up various test facilities, and now the carrier suitability demonstration when the indigenous aircraft carrier which is being built at Cochin Shipyard will basically come out. So some of these pictures performing the ski jump and field carrier landing practice, a night ski jump launch, and I'll show you a video of the night launch. It looks quite nice. So I see that I was told that grade are basically first year students, so to say. So I think a lot of this probably goes over your head. I'm not sure. I hope you were able to pick it up. But let me try to keep it within the realms of that. You know, this morning people who attended also, there's a requirement capture. This is a process that you go through, a complete design and development process. I'll probably do that in this slide itself. So what happens is, say the Indian Navy will give that my aircraft has to do a ski jump takeoff arrested recovery. So that's one requirement. Like that, you have multiple set of requirements a typical naval aeroplane should have. Like for example, it operates from sea atmosphere. That means you should have non-corrosive elements that are there. Otherwise, it will corrode. Probably Bangalore, you must be familiar with it. Corrosion is a big problem. So you need to have non-corrosive environment. Like that, you set out 100, 150 requirements are captured in a requirement table. Build up a concept model initially. And once you do that, you start carrying out your initial computational fluid dynamics, which are coming up. Carry out basic design, analysis, manufacture. Manufacture today, all these, all these are virtual manufacturing tools are available today. You carry out the entire aircraft integration assembly and testing. I will cover some of these subsequently, and in-flight test. So what technologies have been there in this program? In terms of design and development tools, it had to be built up. Everything had to be built up. How do you do CAD? I don't know whether in the first year you have any CAD exposure. You have. Which software are you using? Then certification methodology that are there. Manufacturing assembly technologies that come in, and testing methods and test facilities. Because to create a test facility, like the shore-based test facility we have to create, conceptualizing that itself was a big challenge. So it's not just the aircraft which is a challenge, it's a test facility itself is a challenge also. So this is something that we have to do. Quality inspection and assurance inspection, and of course, development of human resources in the various disciplines that are there. How did the tools evolve? As I mentioned in the morning, started with Leonardo da Vinci at 1488 when he did sketching of a basic aircraft concept. So after that, of course, I'm from an era of T-square and drawing board. Then I think it all moved to mini drafters and whatever. And now I believe it's only CAD. There's no mini drafters also. So I think even this drawing board and drafters are gone. But then it started with 2D sketch, you know, even in the CAD domain, it started with 2D, something like AutoCAD, some people must be familiar. So it started with that, and then it moved to 3D. And from 3D, it is a collaborative environment. So it's kind of graduated over the time. But like I said in the morning, you need to have that ability to sketch, because that's the communication. Like I said, the test facility at Goa, we built with the Russians who are supplying some of the equipment, the chief designers of the Russian side. So it helps to, you know, kind of interact with them. On language is no barrier if you are able to sketch out in engineering. That's the important thing. So please maintain that habit of sketching out. It also builds a good concept in your mind. That's the important thing. So what happens today is you build up a collaborative environment for your design analysis space. Means you have your major tools that are there, like for design, maybe CATIA, PLM, that is product lifecycle management, you have, you know, we are team center, etc. Analysis, people could be using NASTRA and Abacus, etc. Simulation tools, because like whatever those landing gear, arrest hook, everything, you can actually do a simulation. So you have to write your simulation codes. You can use various tools like ADAM, CELESDYNA, SIMULIA, etc. And manufacturing, DELMIA probably. And major elements which are there are that you have to have structural drawings, system drawings, digital mock-up, finite element modeling and stress analysis, and tool design. So you use a program management as your heart, and you have an external partner if you have. You have to link through them, because it's not everything that you do yourself. You may be doing linked with them. So it's a collaborative environment. That means when you're actually doing a structural design, somebody may be doing a hydraulic system, say, about 100 miles away. Fine, no problem. It's connected. You're able to see. So it's a concurrent engineering environment that is actually built up. That is what was built up within this program. And then you have the main design team which is controlling the whole thing. So various tools that are there are basically in terms of computer-aided design, computational fluid dynamics, finite elements, virtual reality, and I see a virtual reality lab which is also there in the same building. I saw it. You have ergonomics, and I'll cover that. Immersive visualization. You have to do a wiring. You do a building wiring, you do car wiring, all that is a electrical harness mechanism. So all that can be done in CAD today. That means you do a space allocation, because you have space as a premium in an aircraft. You need to have less weight, space is an absolute premium. So you can do the entire thing virtually. all your system pipelines which are there, akin to what is there in your car or your building, whatever, you can actually do that. You can use the same tools for all this. Aerospace is an example. The same thing is applicable everywhere, including automobiles or buildings, whatever, not an issue. So you create a collaborative environment in a product lifecycle management. You can go to digital manufacturing, robotics, and then finally high-speed machining. These are the kind of tools that are there. So what happens? You've been given a set of requirements. Based on these requirements, you need to start building up what is your configuration. What do you want? You can have different types of configuration of an aircraft, a fighter aircraft. You know, like you can have a conventional fuselage, a wing, a tailplane, a vertical fin. Fighters are there. Or you can have a delta wing aircraft purely, like the Tejas is. No, there's no tail, there's only a vertical fin. Or you can have a delta wing with a canard, something like your Rafale which is coming in, or your Gripen that is there, or Eurofighter, all of them are with a canard. That is a small control surface. Instead of a tailplane, you have a foreplane. A foreplane is called a canard. So these are different configurations, but it's up to the design what you choose. So what we did in the naval version was, though the Air Force version was a tailless delta purely, we added a levcon, which is hybrid between a canard and a foreplane control surface, because we wanted that control there without changing much of the configuration. So that is what we basically do. So it's a designer's call on which configuration to choose. Once you've chosen that configuration, you make that configuration work by simulation. So in the configuration process, like I said, you do various different models, and there are no aero students, I think, in this. Fine. What happens importantly, and I mentioned in the morning, in terms of environmental impact, you need to minimize drag. That means your resistance to airflow as the aircraft is moving, both in subsonic flight and supersonic flight, you need to minimize that. And how do you minimize drag? You have to generate your drag curves and then check where can you start optimizing your shape so that you have minimal drag. Right? There's something called an area rule. I'll not get into that detail, but there's something called an area rule which is used for checking. An ideal low drag curve is a bell curve in an area rule. If you can get that, everybody tries to get into that. That's the kind of a thing. So once you build a configuration, you have a scale model is built up with a tunnel, and you carry out a wind tunnel analysis. So you have done some prediction in computational fluid dynamics. You validate that prediction by a scale model test in a wind tunnel. And based on that, you proceed further to detailed design. Here in the wind tunnel, you generate what are your forces that are coming on the model, what are the moments that are coming, what are the inertias that are coming, because these are all inputs that are required for the flight control system team for him to design the control law. One, it also gives you the aerodynamic performance. Also, it gives inputs for the flight control system team to actually carry out this analysis. And then, of course, you finally validate that in flight test, and if there is a correction required, you correct the model. So what I wanted to say today, computational fluid dynamics in the country has reached a level, because a lot of computational fluid dynamics software is written in ADA in-house. So with these CFD tools, we have actually done a prediction of a typical bomb drop. You see, this is a prediction of a bomb drop. And this is a bomb drop at Jaisalmer. Pokhran, you must have heard, where the nuclear explosive was fired. So Pokhran is in Rajasthan, in Jaisalmer. So we had the bomb drop there at Jaisalmer. You see that it's practically matching whatever was our prediction in actual flight test. So that is where our computational fluid dynamics and predictions and simulation tools have reached. You can actually go through this very carefully. Similarly, on a laser guided bomb, you see this is the prediction and this is the actual, you know, drop which is captured by another aircraft which is flying next to it. So this is the kind of this is the important thing. That's the message that I want to give, that we have adequate confidence in the CFD techniques to